Men and women can't be friends because the sex part always gets in the way.
Before we start the video, I have an announcement. I got a cow tattoo. Her name is Daisy because she's got a little daisy in her mouth. Check out our girl, Big D. And if you're wondering who did it, the artist is a cow whisperer named Bunny's Tattoos, so go check her out. Siggy was there when I got it done, and so was the cow, but you won't see her because she was filming. And Bunny gave me a sticker because I was brave. So yeah, it was a great day, and I'm happy that I can now reveal her to you. And if you're new here and you're wondering, why are you showing me a cow? Well, firstly, welcome. Secondly, my name is Tara Mooney, and this is the only channel on YouTube where all videos are written and produced by a cow. She couldn't be in the video today because she's getting vaccinated, baby. But if you like and subscribe, she might appear in the next. Specifically, I want to look at the friends to lovers trope in TV and film. It isn't always badly done, but when it is, oh boy. And it's worth noting that I'll mainly be talking about straight relationships in this. Although recently we've seen more queer representation, the friends to lovers trope is mainly represented by guy-girl friendships. When it is used in queer situations, it's usually used as a plot device for the protagonist to come out. I think it'd be cool to see more representation of queer people post coming out and living their best lives, but that's just me. Now, the idea of friends turning into lovers isn't inherently bad or messy. It's nice to date someone you already know and get along with, and friendship, of course, is the foundation of a good relationship. The best portrayals of this phenomenon are when characters have genuine chemistry, and it doesn't feel like it's just come out of nowhere. Firstly, we've got Jake and Amy from Brooklyn Nine-Nine, who have a long friendship before finally getting together. And it's cute and satisfying because you always felt their chemistry and anticipated that it might happen eventually. Another good example are Jess and Nick from New Girl. Now, this one is interesting to me, and The Take actually did a very in-depth video all about why this relationship is so well written. But to summarize, Jess and Nick show that friendships and romances aren't necessarily either all things. They are friends, they get together, then break up, and become even stronger friends. As well as being friends, they're exes. And being friends with an ex can be valuable because that person knows what you are like in a relationship, so when you confide in them for relationship advice, they can give you valuable insight. So instead of showing that tension and anticipation, which I would argue is a bit overdone, you've got a depiction of a friendship between exes that strengthens their bond and allows them time to work on themselves and be with other people, eventually leading them to get back together, which is even better than the first time because you know at this point they know that they are compatible for one another. Now that I've said some positive things, let's talk about my problems with this trope, because I'm a moany bitch. But before we do, let's hear a word, well, more like 220 words, from today's sponsor. For the second time, today's video is sponsored by ExpressVPN. And you know, number twos are the best. ExpressVPN is a virtual private network, which is a secure tunnel between your device and the internet. VPNs protect you from online snooping, interference, and censorship. I've been using ExpressVPN since before I even started YouTube, and my absolute favorite feature is its location changing tool, so you can watch shows that aren't available in your region. The other day, I found rewatching Adventure Time, which isn't available on UK Netflix, but I used ExpressVPN to switcheroo to Japanese Netflix, and voila, I was hanging out with Finn and Jake. You can use ExpressVPN to unlock Netflix libraries and other streaming libraries in so many other countries, giving you thousands of more shows for you to watch. And now that things are opening up, I might start working in cafes and other public places. ExpressVPN is crucial for protecting me while on public Wi-Fis. When you use public Wi-Fi, it is crucial to be protected. Hackers on the same network can steal your data, and network ads admins can see your online activity, so there's no privacy. But ExpressVPN can help with that. ExpressVPN encrypts 100% of your network data, so you are protected from your personal information being stolen. If you want to be protected from those pesky thieves and watch all the shows you want, sign up for ExpressVPN and get 3 months for free by going to expressvpn.com/Tara Mooney or by clicking the link in the description. Thank you so much to ExpressVPN for sponsoring today's video. So I'm going to complain now. I have a lot of issues with the friends to lovers trope, and the first being that I think it's just lazy writing. Especially when you see this in teen movies where the female protagonist has been wronged by a guy.
I messed with her. Yeah, Kimmy, I messed with her and she was pissed at me.
What'd you do?
Rather than her ending up single and happy with herself, it's as if the writers are like, well, she's gotta end up with someone. And they just pick the friend who's been there all along, even though they have zero chemistry.
The crazy thing is you don't even know a thing about her, man. What's her birthday, huh? What's her middle name? What's her favorite color? What color are her eyes, man?
Green.
No, they're not, they're blue.
And she's never expressed any attraction towards him before.
This is Jack Dunkelman. And you may be asking, why is he carrying his books in a milk crate? Well, I've been friends with him for years, and that's still a mystery to me. What's even more of a mystery is why he's crazy about someone twice his size.
Good morning.
Hi.
So David Blaine called me? You'll never believe it. He just wants to know when you and I are gonna make magic together.
You do this every day, Dunkelman. It's never gonna happen.
Now, some of you might hate me for this, but Lizzie, in the Lizzie McGuire movie,
Paolo is just a liar. This has all been some crazy scheme to set you up and embarrass you on stage so it looks like Isabella can't sing.
See, it's true.
Paolo wants to destroy Isabella's career.
But Paolo would never do that to me. I don't believe you. Lizzie, who are you going to believe? This boy you are knowing your whole life, or this boy you are just meeting?
Should not have ended up with Gordo. Now, in fairness, they hinted at Gordo fancying Lizzie before this, but she just didn't reciprocate.
Messages received.
Hey, it's Gordo from Lizzie McGuire. You guys have been sending me all this email, and lots of you want to know, do you have a crush on Lizzie? Me and my friends all think she likes you. Everybody always asks me that.
Now, Lizzie, I know we're best friends, but sometimes I feel like you take me for granted. Like now.
What?
Look, there are just some things you don't talk about, okay?
And because Mr. Popstar Guy, who's also in Pretty Little Liars, turns out to be a phony,
I know what this is.
She gets with Gordo. I'm sorry, but I don't see it. And I found the clip of their awkward kiss on YouTube and the comments. Gordo is really the most patient boy I have ever met. You've met him? Lizzie is lucky to have him. Other guys would have given up. Honestly, I'm really happy that Gordo is finally out of the friend zone. And that brings me on to my next point. This trope reinforces the toxic concept of friend zones and vindicates self-described nice guys. And when I say nice guys, I mean guys that describe themselves as nice and therefore feel entitled to women. So they're not actually that nice. And the case study for this point is a bad film in general, and that is...
You know that really, really tall girl that you go to school with?
Would you maybe wanna...
Tall Girl. The film is badly written and the protagonist isn't likable at all, but I still didn't want her to end up with Dunkers or whatever his name was. He's kind of creepy.
You fall in love, stick together through college, down the line you get married, have a baby, and the combined strength of your tall gene and his tall gene creates a zygote in your belly the size of an above average sized watermelon. So that would mean that that puppy's coming out cesarean. Now, do you really want to go through the rest of your life with a big old scar on that beautiful torso of yours?
And doesn't understand boundaries. And even sabotages her relationship with the not Swedish guy.
With Jody, and she kissed me, and I kissed her back, and I didn't pull away. So what should I do?
Win a Date with Tad Hamilton also has a character like this, and he's even worse. so much worse. Because at least the tall girl nice guy is a teenager, so he could grow out of it. But in this film, a grown-ass man says this to his friend.
Just do me one favor, okay? Guard your carnal treasure.
Okay.
Okay, no, I just guard your carnal treasure.
Thanks, Pete.
Okay. Sir, that's not okay. It's also insulting writing because it implies that the female protagonists are just dumb. Like, they knew all along they were the right guy for her, but she just didn't see him right in front of her eyes. No doesn't mean no. Just be persistent, fellas. Or she's her own person and doesn't owe you shit. And maybe you shouldn't just be friends with someone because you hope it will eventually lead to you getting with them.
I really don't get why you don't just put your stuff in a backpack like a normal person.
Well, because I knew the day would come where I would need it, and I wanted to be ready.
Ready for what?
For this. Now, do you really want to go through the rest of your life with a big old scar on that
beautiful torso of yours?
Into your crusty little crate and leave us all alone. And of course, this trope reinforces the notion that men and women, boys and girls, guys and girls, can't just be friends. Putting aside how heteronormative this belief is, it does a disservice to wonderful and meaningful platonic friendships between men and women. Remember that clip from the beginning of the video? Well, that's from a film called When Harry Met Sally, and you might be surprised to hear that I don't think this film is a bad example of the friends to lovers trope.
What I'm saying is, and this is not a comment in any way, shape, or form, is that men and women can't be friends because the sex part always gets in the way.
That's not true. I have a number of men friends and there is no sex involved.
No, you don't.
Yes, I do.
No, you don't.
Yes, I do.
You only think you do.
You're saying I'm having sex with these men without my knowledge?
No, what I'm saying is they all want to have sex with you.
They do not.
Do too.
They do not.
Do too.
How do you know?
Because no man can be friends with a woman that he finds attractive. He always wants to have sex with her.
So you're saying that a man can be friends with a woman he finds unattractive?
No, you pretty much want to nail him too.
What if they don't want to have sex with you?
It doesn't matter, because the sex thing is already out there, so the friendship is ultimately doomed, and that is the end of the story.
Well, I guess we're not going to be friends then.
Guess not.
So Harry is a sexist character, obviously, but I don't think that necessarily means the message of the film is.
Ooh, Ingrid Bergman. Now she's low maintenance.
Low maintenance?
There are two kinds of women, high maintenance and low maintenance.
And Ingrid Bergman is low maintenance?
An LM, definitely.
Which one am I?
You're the worst kind. You're high maintenance, but you think you're low maintenance.
I don't see that.
You don't see that? Waiter, I'll begin with a house salad, but I don't want the regular dressing. I'll have the balsamic vinegar and oil, but on the side. And then the salmon with the mustard sauce, but I want the mustard sauce on the side. On the side is a very big thing for you.
Well, I just want it the way I want it.
I know. High maintenance.
Here's the thing. The film came out in 1989, and the big question on the posters was, can men and women be friends, or does sex always get in the way? Now, if I saw this on a film poster now, I'd roll my eyes. But in fairness, this film interrogates this question and doesn't give a definitive answer. In my opinion, I'm not a film critic. Don't eat me alive. Now, in that scene I showed you earlier, some men who watch it do agree with what Harry's saying, which is, before this movie, women had no idea the great unspoken truth. He is 100% correct, ladies, FYI. But of course, they will deny it. And I found a TED talk about whether men and women can just be friends, and here's some more delightful comments. Reads title, oh, this is going to be good. Grand, we get to listen to a woman's utopian fantasy for 15 mins. Wow, talk about living in fantasy land. She is basing the ability for men and women being friends based on some childhood relationship she had with a boy she knew. So you think guys and girls can't be friends? And she's wrong for basing her opposite belief on lived experience. As in, she did it. She was just friends with a boy. It happened. They were fine. They didn't spontaneously combust. More friendships equals more brothers trapped in the friend zone. Interestingly, when I looked at studies investigating whether men and women can just be friends, they found that it was mostly men that believed this to be the case, whereas women didn't. Here's something.
Just because men think something is true doesn't make it true.
Silly women, look at their stupid pretty little heads thinking they can be just friends with guys. I sexualize every woman I come into contact with, so all men are like this.
Thankfully, they aren't. Now, if you're friends with someone of a gender you're attracted to, you will at least ruminate about hooking up with them. But that doesn't mean the friendship is doomed. In fact, you can even be friends with someone you're sexually attracted to. It's called self-control. Or if you hook up and can be mature about it and not let it make things awkward, that's also great. That being said, When Harry Met Sally is a good film, and I'm not trying to cancel it. If dudes cheer on Harry's monologue, then that's on them. There are moments in the film where Sally challenges Harry's arrogance.
Why are you getting so upset? This is not about you.
Yes, it is. You are a human affront to all women, and I am a woman.
Hey, I don't feel great about this, but I don't hear anyone complaining.
Of course not. You're out the door too fast.
I think they have an okay time.
How do you know?
Like when he claims that a woman has never faked an O with him because he would know.
How do you know that they're really?
What are you saying? That they fake orgasm?
It's possible.
Get out of here.
Why? Most women at one time or another have faked it.
Or they haven't faked it with me.
How do you know?
Because I know.
Oh. Right. That's right. I forgot. You're a man.
What is that supposed to mean?
Nothing. It's just that all men are sure it never happened to them, and most women at one time or another have done it, so you do the math.
You don't think that I could tell a difference?
No.
Get out of here.
We get the most iconic scene where she fakes an O in a cafe, and it's great. Harry gets destroyed. The worst iteration of this trope is the childhood best friend to lovers trope. Ugh. That irks me. The idea that people grow up together and are childhood best friends then fall in love is overrepresented. I'm not saying it never happens, it just doesn't happen as much as the movies want you to think it does. I'm sorry, do you really think I can believe that someone could grow up with Ron Weasley and end up wanting to boink him? He's like Hermione's annoying, dumber brother. I'm sorry, but I don't buy it. I'm still reeling over Lizzie and Gordo. I remember seeing it when I was about 7 years old, and you couldn't even convince me then that they had chemistry. Though, on a brighter note, I think the childhood besties to lovers trope is fizzling out. The kissing booth, despite all its flaws, is a good example of a depiction of a totally platonic boy-girl friendship.
Okay, listen, can you keep your phone on you, though? Because I honestly, I know myself, and I'm gonna run out of things to talk about, and I really wanna call you.
No.
Know myself?
No, do not call me, okay? If he can't see how completely baller you are, then he's not the right guy for you.
It doesn't even entertain that they will get together, which I appreciate. Let's stop undermining friendship. Like the phrase, just friends. I mean, I get it, but also, why is a romantic relationship considered superior to a friendship? In films and TV, and even in real life, it's considered to be the end goal, the top tier kind of relationship. But friendships can be just as or even more fulfilling. So
stop that!
I'm done complaining now. Thanks for listening. Here's today's subscription pet shout out. So this is Seamus, who's around 4 years old. He was originally found in the trash and has been living a spoiled life ever since. He loves fish, his Uncle Jack, and screaming.
Yeah.
Mm. Let's give him a round of applause. If you liked this video, make sure to give it a like, because one like equals one nuanced representation of men and women friendship. And make sure to subscribe, because when you do subscribe, you become a little subscription. And when you become a little subscription, I will keep you underneath my pillow with the rest of my little subscriptions. And wouldn't that be delightful? Right, I'm off. Bye-bye. Bye-bye now. Bye-bye. Bye-bye now. Bye-bye.